Good morning. I'd like to welcome everybody to the morning session, assuming that sound asked the right Steve Miller to be doing the introductions right now. Since we were graduate students together, I'm assuming he does know which Steve Miller to ask. So it's my pleasure to welcome the first speaker, Nalini Anatharaman, who will be talking to us about quantum ergodicity on large graphs.
Okay. So what I'm going to talk about today, the motivation comes from, can you hear me? So my motivation comes from quantum chaos. In physics, there is this general and maybe a bit vague question, which is to classify systems into universality classes. At one end, there should be the completely integrable systems. At the opposite end, there should be the chaotic systems. And in between, there should be some intermediate classes, not very well identified. But the idea is that within each class, you should see some universal behavior. For instance, for the completely integrable systems, when you look at them from the point of view of quantum mechanics, that is to say, when you consider the corresponding Schrödinger equation, you expect to see a spectrum that looks like a Poisson process. And you expect to see eigenfunctions that are localized in a small portion of phase space. For the chaotic system, on the other hand, when you look at the spectrum of the Schrödinger operator, it is believed that you will see something which looks like the spectrum of a large random matrix. And it is believed that the eigenfunctions of chaotic systems should be delocalized in phase space. So these ideas have been tested experimentally of atoms or atoms in magnetic fields. They have also been tested numerically on certain billiards and on certain Riemannian manifolds. There are many conjectures. One of the most famous is the quantum unit ergodicity conjecture, which was formulated by Rudnick and Sarnak. And there have been substantial advances related to these conjectures, but we are still lacking a global understanding of these questions. So since the 90s, there has been the idea of testing testing these conjectures and these questions on graphs. The feeling is that graphs are a simpler object than manifolds. After having spent a couple of years working on graphs, I'm not sure it's true, but anyway, they are certainly simpler if you want to do numerical simulations, and they're also simpler if you want to work out explicitly explicit expression on simple examples. I don't know if the point, okay. So since the 90s, there has been many papers, mostly by Smilansky, Kotos and their collaborators, and John Keating and his collaborators. And most papers have been dedicated to the study of metric graphs, also sometimes called quantum graphs, which are one-dimensional objects, one-dimensional CW complexes where you glue together segments and you put a Schrödinger operator on each segment with a matching condition and the vertices. But it's not this kind of models I want to talk about today. For the last decade, Uzi Smilansky has been advertising the idea of working with discrete graphs. And in particular, the work I'm going to talk about today has been motivated by a paper by Smilansky called Discrete Graphs, a Paradigm Model for Quantum Chaos. And more explicitly, in his papers, he's been studying a lot regular graphs, large, finite, regular graphs. So we are also following this model. So we consider graphs of size n, so finite graphs of size n. N is going to go to infinity, but the valency of the graph is fixed q plus 1. And the main object we are interested in are the eigenfunctions of the discrete Laplacian. So on a graph, on a discrete graph, the Laplacian of a function. So if I have a function f on the set of vertices, its Laplacian at a point x is the sum over neighbors of x of f of y minus f of x. And since I'm working with regular graph, all points have the same number of neighbors, so this is also the sum over neighbors of f of y minus q plus 1 f of x. In other words, for regular graph, they have the particularity that the Laplacian is the same as the adjacency matrix modulo some translation of q plus 1 identity. So this is going to be the main subject of our study. And since we'll be taking sequences of graphs of size going to infinity, and we need, of course, to make some assumption about the way that grow to infinity. So the main assumption would be that our graph has few short loops. So if you want, let's assume that the girth, the length of the shortest loops, is going to infinity. But this actually can be relaxed a little. So we assume that around most points, the graph looks like a tree, but actually we would be allowed a small number of bad points where we have small loops. And already this has a consequence on the empirical spectral measure for the graph. If I consider the empirical measure, so I put a delta lambda I here, are the eigenvalues of the Laplacian, of the discrete Laplacian, or maybe of the adjacency matrix. Under this assumption of having few short loops, it's known that the empirical measures measure when lambda goes to infinity has a limit with the density. So let's say there are the eigenvalues of the adjacency matrix. In our situation, the spectrum of the adjacency matrix has to be always between minus q plus 1 and q plus 1. And here, we, under the assumption of having few short loops, the explicit limit measure, it's known, it's called the Kesten or the Plancherel measure of the tree, or the Kesten measure. It's known to have a density, which has it completely explicit, in a strictly smaller interval here. So this is the density, this is the function rho. And before stating our own result, I want also first to talk about a result that was proven a few years ago and that also was a motivation for our work. It's a paper by Shimon Brooks and Ellen Lindenstrauss. And they assume, so for this statement here, they assume something stronger than what I said. They don't only assume that the girth is going to infinity, but actually that the girth is logarithmic. And under this assumption, they can prove some result, some kind of delocalization result for the eigenfunctions of the Laplacian. And it reads as follows. If you fit some epsilon, and you assume that you have a subset of the set of vertices, so you phi here is an eigenfunction of the Laplacian, and they will always be normalized to have L2 norm equal to 1. And you assume that you have a subset of the set of vertices for which the mass, the sum of phi h squared over b, is larger than epsilon, then the cardinality of b, what they prove is that the cardinality of b must be larger than some power of n. And here the power delta depends on epsilon and on c here. Okay, so it says that it's not possible for, if you, to each eigenfunction you associate a probability measure on the set of vertices, it's not possible for this probability measure to concentrate on a set that is too small. And in passing, this necessarily implies that the L infinity norm of the eigenfunctions goes to zero, But if you look more carefully at their proof, it gives some logarithmic decay of the L infinity norm. So in the next slide, we will also be interested in this probability measure. So for each eigenfunction, we want to associate a probability measure on the set of vertices. And we will try to compare this probability measure to the uniform measure. So this is the main result of this talk. And we call it quantum ergodicity on graphs because it's supposed to remind of a result which is called quantum ergodicity on manifolds. And so not to be confused with quantum unique ergodicity. So quantum ergodicity is also on a manifold. It's also called the Schneerellman theorem. And on a manifold, we are really usually interested in eigenfunctions of the Laplacian on a fixed manifold, but when the eigenvalue goes to infinity. And I'm not going to give the statement, but I just want to comment on the name because it's a fancy name. So here, quantum means that this equation can be seen as a particular case of a Schrödinger equation. And ergodicity means that somewhere in the result, we want to use some ergodic property of the geodesic flow. And our aim was to try to transpose this result to graphs. So now on a graph, it has not much to do with quantum mechanics. And there will be maybe some ergodic theory, but not much. So the name is maybe a bit exaggerated, but it's there just to recall of the existence of the theorem on the manifold. So the assumption, first, we assume that our graph has few short loops, so let's say girths going to infinity, and we want to assume that they form an expander family, which means that I want a fixed spectral gap beta on both sides on the spectrum. So here beta, there is always, q plus one is always a trivial eigenvalue for the adjacency matrix. But then I want a fixed spectral gap on both sides here, beta. So already I know that there are relatively few eigenfunctions in this interval because of this limit law, but I really want a fixed interval without eigenvalues. And we consider an orthonormal basis of eigenfunction of the Laplacian or of the adjacency matrix. And we want to for each eigenfunction, we build a probability measure on the vertices just by considering phi x squared. And we want to compare this probability measure to the uniform measure. So we take a test function A on the set of vertices. We assume that this function A has mean zero. And we assume that it's bounded. And the statement is that we average over the spectrum a certain positive quantity, which is here we consider the average of A with respect to the probability measure phi x squared. And the statement is that the limit of this goes to zero, is zero. What is the interpretation? Note that we are taking an average of positive number, non-negative number. So if this average is small, necessarily most of the terms have to be small. It could happen that a small proportion of terms are large and is not forbidden by the theorem. So here is an equivalent statement. Now I'm not assuming that my function A has mean zero, but it doesn't matter. I will just, so here now I compare the average of A for the probability measure phi x squared with the average of A for the uniform measure. A bar here means the average of A for the uniform measure. And again, what the statement says is that for most, I suppose I'm given a test function A, then for most eigenfunctions here, the average of A for phi x squared is close to the average of A for the uniform measure. But it's not telling me for which eigenfunctions it's true. So if I want to compare this with the statement, the result of Brutz and Linderstrauss, they are a bit different in nature because their result is true for all eigenfunctions, for individual eigenfunctions, and it's telling me that the probability measure cannot concentrate on a small set. So it's far from telling me that the probability is uniform. Whereas this result tells me that the probability is close to uniform, but only for a majority of eigenfunctions. And it's close to uniform in a rather weak sense. It's not in total variation, for instance. It's just the average of A is close. And maybe a remark I should make is that here I'm denoting A, but actually because A is defined on a set depending on N, actually across I have a sequence of test functions. But, and I'm assuming that this sequence is uniformly bounded. Two remarks. The first one, here I'm averaging over the whole spectrum, but actually we could strengthen this a little. It's possible to average over shrinking spectral intervals, provided they shrink not too fast around the value in the bulk of the spectrum. And the second remark is that, so this is a deterministic statement. I'm just considering a sequence of graphs that I'm assuming satisfies certain assumptions, and I have a result. But very often, people are interested in random regular graphs, which means the following. If you fix the number of n of vertices, you can consider the set of all regular graphs on these vertices. You can try to count them. Some people know how to do that. It's not obvious. And then you can put the uniform measure on this set. And this gives a meaning to picking a regular graph at random. And it's known that a random regular graph with high probability has few short loops in this, it can have some short loops, but not many, and that they form an expander family. So this result in particular applies to random regular graphs, and actually you could also make a probabilistic proof if you use some estimates that are contained in a recent paper by Leander Geisinger. Suppose you're just interested in the random situation and your observable A is independent on the graph. Then using his estimate, you can show that the expectation of this thing is going to zero. Okay, now, like in the case of quantum ergodicity of manifolds, I want to generalize the result to more general operators than just multiplication operators. So the setting is the same assumption, but now I want to consider an operator on L2 of the graph, so that is to say a matrix indexed by the vertices. And I want to consider the scalar product phi I, k, phi I. And again, k necessarily has to depend on n, but I'm not always putting this in the notation. And so I'll assume that k is zero at some fixed distance d from the diagonal. And I would like a statement saying that the average over the spectrum of phi I, k, phi I, absolute value, is zero. No.
So then k phi I is in the first component?
Well, if it's anti-symmetric, I don't have anything to do. But so, yeah, you can assume it's symmetric if you want. So that's the question. What should you assume? Because the previous result was just the special case where k is multiplication operator, and I was assuming that the average of A was zero. So now the question is, what should we assume here? And in the paper with Etienne, the assumption here is written in a quite strange way. And just 2 months ago, I realized that the assumption can be explained in a much simpler way than what is in the paper. And no, you should not only assume that the trace is zero. You should assume the following. So to explain the assumption, it's better to work on the tree. So I'll lift everything to the tree. So I'll say that my graph is a quotient of the Q plus one regular tree by some group of automorphism. So now my matrix K, I see it as an operator on the, so H here, this is the Q plus one regular tree. I assume I have an operator on the tree which vanishes at distance d from the diagonal, and now it has to be invariant under the diagonal action of gamma. And the assumption I want on K, so maybe so I'll draw the tree like a hyperbolic disk. And here is a fundamental domain for the action of gamma, and I call it D. So it's just a copy of the graph inside my tree. And I want that for any M, the sum, so here I'm summing over the fundamental domain, X. So it's a sum over vertices, and now I'm summing, for each X, I'm summing over all Y, which are at distance M from X, but in the tree. So for each X, I'm drawing the sphere of radius M in the tree. And I'm summing all k of h y for all such x and y, and this should be zero for any m. Another way of putting this is that the trace in L2 of the tree of k composed with the Laplacian to the power m and restricted to my fundamental domain should be zero for any m. Or if you want, this is saying that the operator K is orthogonal to any power of the Laplacian in a certain Hilbert space. And this Hilbert space is, so it depends on the finite graph, so it depends on N, is the space of operators on the tree that are invariant under the diagonal action of gamma. And the norm is the Hilbert-Schmidt norm on the tree of K restricted to the fundamental domain. And note that this is not the same as the Hilbert-Schmidt norm of the operator on the finite graph. Okay, so actually you should assume that K is orthogonal to any power of the Laplacian in this Hilbert space. So now here is the final statement. Now I have an arbitrary operator, I'm always assuming that it's supported near the diagonal. If I have an arbitrary operator, I can consider its orthogonal projection to the vector space generated by the powers of the Laplacian. So it gives me a function of the Laplacian depending on k. So I call this function fk. And the final statement is written here, that if I average over the spectrum, so now this is a statement on the quotient, on the finite graph, and I'm comparing the scalar product phi I k phi I with the function fk evaluated at lambda I. Well, lambda I is the eigenvalue corresponding to phi I. Okay, so it's the result is telling me that for almost all eigenfunctions, these two quantities are closed. And note, so again, so in general, this quantity here depends on the eigenvalue, but if K is just a multiplication operator, it doesn't, you just get the average of A. Or if you have in mind the usual quantum ergodicity on a manifold, this would be the average of the symbol on some energy layer. And actually, I was quite glad when I realized that this quantity could be defined in a quite simple way, much simpler than what is written in the paper, because now the result really looks like it could be generalized to Laplacian plus potential or non-regular graph. But I'll discuss that at the end of the talk.
So in that case, you always have to make consider the differential operator of order zero. So you might go and you look to the tangent space, which is what you're doing here.
Yes.
What should I view as
Is Well, even if you take a zero-order pseudo-differential operator, you always have to compose it with a spectral projection for the. So, I mean, for instance, if you wanted to work on a shrinking interval, you could take an operator. So maybe it will be clearer later. Okay, so now in the remaining time, I want to discuss the proof of this theorem. And I'm going to give two sketches of proof. The first one is the one that is in the paper with Etienne. And I guess if you've never been in contact with quantum ergodicity on a manifold, you will probably find this proof extremely strange. Whereas the second proof I'm going to talk about is just two pages. So and the second proof is better in the sense that it really looks like it could be generalized to non-regular graphs or to Laplacian plus potential. So you may wonder why I'm bothering you with the first proof. Well, the first proof is really modeled on the proof of quantum ergodicity on a manifold. And the reason why we did it this way is that it was the only idea that we had. And I guess this first proof, for people who know quantum ergodicity on a manifold, would be very transparent. It really tries to follow the same steps. And also, a reason why I like this first proof is that it's a surprise that it works. I remember 4 years ago, I was discussing this idea with Lior Silberman, and he told me, you can't make phase space analysis on a graph because you don't have the method of stationary phase, you don't have integration by part. And actually, he was right. You don't have the method of stationary phase on a graph. And several times, I had the impression that our idea was completely stupid. So at the end, it's a relief and it's a surprise that you can really write a proof that it's similar to the proof on quantum ergodicity on a manifold. And that's why I still want to show what we did. But I agree that when you see the second proof, the first one really seems too complicated. So as in the case of a manifold, it relies on phase space analysis on a graph. And to do phase space analysis on a manifold, you use the fact that locally a manifold looks like Rn. So you can use the Fourier transform, the Euclidean Fourier transform in local coordinates to understand the singularities of your linear partial differential equation. And this is the theory that was developed to perfection by Riemannian. On a regular graph, we want to use the same idea, use the fact that local near each point, the graph looks like a tree, to use the Fourier transform on the regular tree and try to copy micro-local analysis, but on a graph. And this is really actually why we need our graph to be regular. We need all points to look similar because we want to use a local model for harmonic analysis near each point. Unfortunately, there exists a very nice Fourier transform on the Q plus one regular tree. I will recall a little how it works. When we have that, it tells us how we should define phase space on the regular tree or on a graph. And it tells us, at least formally, how we should try to define a pseudo-differential operator. I'm not sure it's the right name here, but I mean, just that the definition is copied, but I'm not sure it's really the right name. And at the end, the goal of this complicated construction is to convert our problem, our PDE problem, into a dynamical system problem. So to transform our property of being an eigenfunction for a certain operator into a property of a measure being invariant by a certain dynamics. And for those of you who know the work of Elon Lindenstrauss of quantum unique ergodicity, this was the first step to transform a question of PDE into a question about invariant measures for a flow or for an action. So now a brief reminder, or a brief tutorial about the Fourier transform on a tree. So suppose f is a function on the q plus 1 regular tree. I want to define its Fourier transform. Where did I put this giant chalk? Okay. Its Fourier transform f hat is going to be a function on the boundary at infinity of my tree. So here it's drawn like a circle because I've drawn everything like a hyperbolic space, but it's actually here, it's a counter set. So here omega is a point at infinity on the tree, and s is a real number, or more precisely, a real number modulo 2 pi over log of q. And so the Fourier transform f hat of omega and of s is defined by taking the scalar product between f and a family e sub sw here that plays the role of plane waves. So this family here, they are eigenfunctions of the Laplacian or of the adjacency matrix. They are completely explicit. They are defined in terms of the Boosman functions, or they are also powers of the Poisson kernel of the tree. So you have an explicit basis that plays the role of plane waves on the tree, and it allows you to define the Fourier transform. So it's a function of the boundary and of S in R. And you have an inversion formula. So once you have the Fourier F hat, you can reconstitute F. F is the integral of F hat of omega S times e sub omega s with respect to some measure on s and omega. So here the measure, here this is the Plancherel measure on the tree, and here this is a measure on the boundary of the tree, which is the harmonic measure. You have to choose some origin, and this is the harmonic measure seen from the origin. And you also have a Plancherel theorem, which tells you that the L2 norm of f on the tree is equal to the L2 norm of f hat when you integrate with respect to omega and s for this measure here. And we also need an analog of the Pallet-Wiener theorem, which is actually here due to Crowling and Seti. Pallet-Wiener theorem tells me that the Fourier transform is an isomorphism between functions f that decay sufficiently fast and functions f hat that are smooth in some sense with respect to omega and with respect to s. I'm not going to read the statement in detail, but I just want to stress some differences with the case, the Euclidean case. The first difference, because these differences were sources of problem for us, the first difference is that here you see that the rapidly decaying functions, they are decaying like q to the power minus the distance of h to the origin over 2 over any power of the distance. So these rapidly decaying functions, they are in L2, but they are not in L1. And this was a source of problem for us. And another thing that doesn't seem very important, but was a problem for us, is that the Fourier transform must, there is some redundancy in the Fourier transform. So actually, the Fourier transform satisfies some symmetry condition when you transform S into minus S. So if you want to avoid this redundancy, you should only consider S positive. But, okay. Still, there is a nice Pallet-Wiener theorem. And now it gives us a hint of what we should take as definition of phase space. We are going to really to copy what is done in the Euclidean case. The phase space is going to be the tree X cross the space of Fourier parameters, which is here the boundary cross R modulo 2 pi over log Q. And it has a very nice interpretation, because if I have a point, so it's X cross the boundary of tree cross R modulo 2 pi over log Q. And here, X cross the boundary of X. If you are given a point in the tree and a point at infinity, it's equivalent to be given a half geodesic. So this is the space of half geodesics, which is something that people like in when they, people who do symbolic dynamics like to work with. So this is what we're going to take as phase space. And now we define pseudo-differential operators. Again, I'm not sure it's a proper name, but so for a function A here, which is called a symbol, so A now is a function of phase space, so it's a function of on the space of half geodesics cross R. And for such a function, I define an operator on L2 of the tree by imposing its value on my basis of plane waves. So I ask that op A applied to E sub SW is equal to E sub SW multiplied by A. And in terms of the kernel of the operator, so if K is the kernel of this operator, there is a simple relation between the kernel and the symbol that for fixed X, A of omega S is just the Fourier transform of the kernel with respect to the Fourier, the second variable. And let's note in passing that the adjacency matrix A just corresponds to the function A, which depends only on S, which is 2 square root of Q cross S. So now again, I mean, what the Pallet-Wiener theorem tells us is that the operation of op A gives us an isomorphism between kernels that decay sufficiently fast away from the diagonal and functions and symbols that are smooth with respect to omega and S. I'm not saying in details what it means to be smooth with respect to omega, but and that should satisfy a certain symmetry condition. So, and now we have to think of, I said the aim of all this strange construction is to convert my problem into a problem of dynamical system. So we have to think what kind of dynamical system we want to get at the end. In the manifold case, it's the geodesic flow. And here, well, there is basically just one idea that comes to mind. On this, on the space of half geodesic, what will replace the geodesic flow is just moving the origin towards the endpoint, which is called also the shift. So I have a dynamical system on the space of half geodesic. Which is just you keep the endpoint, but you move the origin forward. So here it's a non-reversible dynamical system. And well, we had a technical problem, which is due to the fact that the composition with the shift doesn't preserve the symmetry condition, so Etienne had to work hard to understand how to deal with that, but I'm not going really to give the detail. And he also showed that the operators that we get this way are bounded on L2. Okay, now we have a construction of a kind of pseudo-differential calculus on the tree. We want to pass it to the quotient. We want something on a quotient of the tree. So now I'm working on a graph G, which is a quotient of the tree by some group of automorphisms. So it means that we want to work with symbols A that are invariant under gamma. So the group of automorphisms acts on the space of half geodesics. So I want A to be gamma invariant. And something that has been, I forgot to say, but this construction here is inspired by a construction of Steve Zeldich on the hyperbolic disk. And something that he had already noted is that the fact that the symbol is gamma invariant is equivalent to the kernel being invariant under the diagonal action of gamma. Yes. So we want to periodize, we want to define the operator on the quotient by periodizing the kernel. Doesn't work very well because the kernel, as I said, the kernel is not decaying very fast. So we do something very brutal. We just cut the kernel away from the diagonal at a certain distance r. And now if we consider our sequence of graph, we want r to be smaller than the girth. And now things are starting to be a bit different from the case of manifolds. For instance, we're not able to show that op A is bounded from L2 to L2 with a bound which is independent on N, but we're just able to show that the normalized Hilbert-Schmidt norm is bounded by the L2 norm of the symbol with respect to... So the measure here is uniform with respect to the vertex, the Plancherel measure in H. And here it's uniform, it's the harmonic measure on omega sin from x. Last step now in the proof is to get something, to get some some invariance by our dynamics, which hopefully would be the shift. And we get, so here is the statement. So let us define V of A, which is often called the quantum variance. So V of A is the quantity we were interested in the theorem. It's the average over the spectrum of phi A up A phi A square. And this is the thing that we would like to prove goes to zero. And obviously, if here I replace up A by the commutator between the Laplacian and up A, I get zero for each individual term. And we are able to translate this into the fact that the variance is almost invariant under the shift. And something also that is different from the case of manifold. In the case of manifold, this is true individually. Each term is almost invariant under the dynamics, whereas here we are only able to prove it. To prove it for the full variance. And so now we are almost done with this complicated proof. We iterate the invariance property. So let STA be the Birkhoff sum of A for the shift. We know that the variance of A is the same as the variance of STA modulo some error term. So the error term here, I forgot to say, it goes to zero when the girth goes to infinity. But there is a constant here which depends on the inverse of the spectral gap. And finally, the last step is to say that the quantum variance is bounded by the Hilbert-Schmidt norm. And we know that the Hilbert-Schmidt norm of this operator is bounded by the L2 norm of the symbol. And finally, here we use again the existence of a spectral gap to show that the L2 norm of the Birkhoff sum of A is bounded by 1 over the spectral gap time t. So to put in all this together, it shows that this quantity can be made arbitrarily small. And here we have an error term which is going to zero. So finally, it shows that the variance goes to zero. And to come back to ZF questions, what is the condition that we should put on A? This is how it is written in the paper with Etienne. So in the paper, it's written like that, that for any fixed S, so S plays the role of the energy layer. So for any fixed S, the average of the symbol with respect to X and omega should be zero. So it really looks as if it depends. It really relies on the Fourier transform. And as I said, it's only recently that I realized that you can rephrase completely this condition without using the notion of symbol, without using the Fourier transform, to get this statement. And now this statement, I mean, the final statement makes sense for non-regular graph or for Laplacian plus potential. So When I realized that, I decided that I also wanted a proof that doesn't rely on the Fourier transform. As I said, I like this proof because it helped me understand actually the proof of quantum ergodicity on the manifold. But now I want also a proof that doesn't rely on the Fourier transform. So here is how it goes. It's very short. You just need to remember the Hilbert space of operators we are working on. So our graph is again a 3-modulo gamma, and we take the space of operators that are invariant under the diagonal action, and the norm is the Hilbert-Schmidt norm on the tree restricted to a fundamental domain. And we consider on this Hilbert space, we consider the following self-adjoint operator, which is just to an operator K, associate the commutator with the Laplacian on the tree. And note that this is not the same as taking the commutator with the Laplacian on the quotient on the Hilbert space, on the Hilbert-Schmidt norm on the quotient. I'm really working on the lift. But still, they are almost the same, provided the operator is supported near the diagonal. So in other words, these two operators are not the same, but you only start to see the difference when you iterate them a number of times that is larger than the girth. And then the short proof relies on these two lemmas. First lemma is that the kernel of L tilde coincides with the closure of the vector space generated by all powers of the Laplacian. So remember, L tilde is the commutator with the Laplacian. So it looks a little surprising because it's not true that on the regular tree, it's not true that an operator which commutes with the Laplacian has to be a function of the Laplacian. But here, it's because I'm assuming a certain summability condition that I want operators in my Hilbert space. Otherwise, any automorphism on the tree commutes with the Laplacian, but it's just that they don't belong to my Hilbert space. And the second lemma, so now I'm taking for an arbitrary operator K, supported near the diagonal, I'm taking 1 over T, integral from 0 to T, and here I'm considering the unitary group generated by L tilde. And as T goes to infinity for a fixed graph, just by a general result, it's converging to the projection of K on the kernel of L tilde. But what here I have is that I have an estimate of the speed of convergence, so some inverse power of T, I'm not sure it's optimal, and here I have a constant which depends only on D, so if you want how far away from the diagonal my operator is supported, and on the spectral gap. Okay, so now if I have a sequence of graphs forming an expander family, it tells me that this convergence here is uniform. And I'm not going to read this slide, but believe me that once you have this, you just need one more page of calculation to show the final theorem. And I like this proof because it really looks like it can be extended to any tree, any graph. But actually, for the moment, these two lemmas, I'm completely able to generalize them to the Laplacian plus a potential or a non-regular. I don't really understand why, because in my opinion, that should be easy. But as soon as I perturb a little the model, I'm no longer able to prove it. So in particular, on a non-regular graph, so here what it is telling me, I think this property of having a uniform convergence, if the graph is regular, it's equivalent to being an expander. If it's non-regular, I don't know what geometric condition I should impose to have this. So I really want to believe that these two properties also hold for more general trees, but for the moment, I can't prove it, and I'm a bit frustrated because, in my opinion, these two lemmas should be the easy part, and the difficult part, which means the part related to the questions that people ask, for instance, in the theory of Anderson localization, should be to understand what this map looked like. You remember you have to subtract some quantity fk of lambda I. In particular, if k is just a multiplication operator, then for each eigenvalue, you get a measure on the set of vertices. Just to A, you associate fa of lambda I. And if the graph is regular, this measure is always the uniform measure independently on the eigenvalue. And I guess if the graph is not regular, this measure could be very far from being uniform. And in my opinion, this should be the interesting part to understand this. And the two lemmas should be the easy part, but still, for the moment, I'm stuck with them. I'm sorry that my birthday present is a bit lousy because I would have liked to have a new result, but I just have two questions and potentially trivial questions. But anyway, the reason why I still wanted to show this question is that in the past, Peter has always encouraged me to talk about proofs that didn't work or ideas that didn't half-finished proofs. And I've always found it very surprising that someone so famous and so busy spends so much time listening to young people who have unfinished proof of results. And
because they often get finished.
Yeah, maybe.
In your case.
No, but I think Peter is not only interested in the final result, he's also interested in what's happening in people's mind and what ideas they have independent. I mean, I remember a time where I was completely stuck with a proof and Peter invited me to New York and said, I know that your proof, he said, I know your proof is not working, but I want to understand why you think it's going to work one day. And for 5 days, he spent 2 or 3 hours every day trying to listen, although he knew there was no result at the end. And I thought it was very generous. So thank you very much, and happy birthday.
Any questions for our speaker?
It's about the function k. You assume that it's average on a ball,
yes.
Is zero.
On a sphere.
Yes. Do you have, I cannot imagine that you could find an example of K which is not symmetric or anti-symmetric. Do you have an example of K satisfying this average zero and which is not symmetric or not anti-symmetric?
Well, if I'm given any operator K, just by doing an orthogonal projection, I can always subtract from it something, and so that the final result will satisfy this condition. Like if you have a function whose mean is non-zero, you can always subtract the constant and make the mean zero. So if you start with any operator, what I'm doing by doing this orthogonal projection, I'm just subtracting a function of the Laplacian so that the difference satisfies the condition.
But you have mean on any ball.
Yes. But the ball, I mean, it's a sphere, so you can do it independently for all radius.
I want to mention a problem which I believe is still open. I remember talking with Peter about it like 25 years ago, and maybe your work and the work of Elon and Brooks can help. For the Riemannian graphs, even though they are kind of optimal from the spectral point of view, they are not known to be optimal from the expansion point of view. And I remember kind of thinking about it long ago, and we realized that it's not enough to know bounds on the eigenvalues. There should be a better understanding of the eigenfunction. Yeah. Now, I wonder now, if you have now a better understanding of the eigenfunction, can you improve?
You mean of the leading eigenfunction? The distribution.
Right. So can you do a better Boozer inequality? You know, the kind of the inverse to Cheeger inequality for a Manoogian graph, getting a better results on the expansion of these graphs. Have you tried this at all, or you don't see? Maybe there is a chance.
I think that numerically you'll find that the Riemannian graphs, which will have spectrum that looks quite, in terms of this distribution, will look like random waves, because that's what's happening in the modular case. So in fact, I think we have discussed this issue a little bit, and I think there are works in progress which are being done that might actually address this by Jung and you and so on. Yeah. I have one other comment, if I may make it.
So you understand what you said, so you think it's...
I think, but not for small sets, I'm afraid. It will help maybe with the constants a little bit.
So you have in mind this special case of...
Riemannian
graphs and HQ eigenfunctions?
Yeah.
So in that case, I guess, assuming some Lindelof
you can say something, yeah, but that's still...
That's what JJ is
trying
doing.
To do, yeah. I think this is connected a bit with Lubowski. So you've shown by the second proof that you don't really need the full boundary in all this harmonic analysis. So if Q is the prime power plus one, and then you do the harmonic analysis just with the group PGLQP, mm-hmm. 2QP, which is a much smaller group than the full automorphism group, and then I think captures everything you have, your statement should fit very naturally into this smaller quotient. In other words, when you look at the full tree, one of the comments you made was you had the full automorphism group of the tree, which wasn't relevant. Only this much smaller group, which
is.
So I still think that, and I think you've tried to look at this a little bit, that if you take QP plus one, so it's got, then the Plancherel measure is the same, and then you have the p-adic diagonal.
So if you take GL to QP, probably the phase space that you will get will be the space of full geodesic.
Right.
You won't have the S in addition. And I think one day it will be written. But so I talked about it with yours yesterday, and your thinks you shouldn't take GL to QP, but the full group of automorphism.
All right, so we obviously have a different view. What you showed in your second proof is that for this, it's much simpler. But I still think your first proof has the advantage of maybe one day proving to understanding quantum unique evidence. Because you're looking for this invariance.
That's why I don't want the first proof to be thrown away, although the new one is...
I think it's an open.
Yeah, from the algebraic point of view, it's got more potential, and the other one maybe for application to the Anderson model or things like that.
I was going to suggest we save the rest of the questions for later in order to stay to the hard deadline of noonish for the photo, but since I see that there is a second microphone...
I just have a quick question, actually.
Yeah.
So your short proof works for regular graphs.
Yes.
Regular graphs are... sort of like constant curvature manifolds. Does it work in the geometric setting in that set?
So first, it's actually also something that should be said. I said this result is supposed to be an analog of quantum ergodicity on a manifold, but quantum ergodicity on a manifold is on a fixed manifold, and lambda goes to infinity. So actually, what our result is more similar to is if you took a sequence of Riemann surfaces, like a sequence of covers. And maybe if you... So for that case, I'm not sure the new proof brings anything, but if you wanted to consider sequences of surfaces, maybe the new proof could work. I've not thought about it. I know also, I forgot to say, but Etienne and Elon and Shimon Wood have also a new proof. That only works also for regular graphs because it relies on the explicit expression of the wave propagator on the tree. And also their new proof is nice because it doesn't use this pseudo-differential formalism. And if you want also to work with sequence of Riemann surfaces, I guess your new proof is better than the one we have. I don't know. But I haven't really thought in details about adaptation to the case of surfaces. I would guess so. Then when you go into the details, you always get surprised. So.
All right, let's thank our speaker again. And then we'll resume in about 5 minutes.